This is the first lecture about how to induce ovulation in XCOR assisted reproduction. What's our aim in induction of ovulation? First is super ovulation. Induction ovulation in XCOR assisted reproduction differ from ordinary induction ovulation because our aim to make super ovulation multiple ova our target. Increase number of the ova means increased success rate. What's the ideal number to yield 10 to 15 ova? Less than this success rate is decreased, more than this increased incidence of ovarian hyperstimulation. Second aim to prevent premature retransition or prevent LH, premature LH surge. The problem of this ovulation occur before oocyte retrieval or ovum pickup. So at time of ovum pickup, I didn't find any ova or decreased number of ova. Last aim to prevent complication like ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome or hyper response. Step by step, we discuss this item. First item, which is the topic of our first lecture, prevent premature retronization or LH surge. In future lecture, we will speak about gonadotropin, a trigger of ovulation, and luteal phase support. How to prevent premature retronization or LH surge? As we know, spontaneous ovulation prior to ovum pickup is occur in about 16% of non-suppressed IVF cycle. ببساطة أنا لو عملت induction ovulation without suppression of cycle المشكلة 16% من الحالات هيحصل لهم spontaneous ovulation وبالتالي at time of ovum pickup I didn't find ovum. So we should do what's called down regulation to prevent LH surge. How to do it? Either using GnRH agonist or antagonist or progesterone in a different protocol. Step by step, we will understand this. First is long protocol using agonist, begin before the induction or before menses in 21 day in previous cycle. So when come menses in second day, give induction or gonadotropin. This is the GnRH analog and this is the induction. Short Freer protocol begin at beginning of the menses and at the same time or one day after this we can give gonadotropin. Last one, antagonist, begin with induction unlike previous two protocol and then give antagonist to prevent LH surge. We will discuss this in details. First one is long agonist protocol. As we say, begin in 21 day of previous cycle. Cycle can be regulated by using combined oral contraceptive or progesterone to schedule the cycle or to make good timing of the cycle. And a 21 day in previous cycle, begin long GnRH agonist. For example, decabutil 0.1, one ampoule per day. Every day give one ampoule, then waiting for menses. And second day, here we begin induction by gonadotropin. Sometimes during in beginning of induction, we may decrease the dose from one ampoule to half ampoule to increase number of ova. Best for normal responder. Is this best protocol and most used protocol in induction of ovulation? And most of physicians are familiar with this protocol. This protocol best one to make synchronization because ovum grow at the same rate at the same time. So we have no problem in if we found two or three follicle is large and another is very small. And best protocol to prevent LH surge. The problem of this protocol is the suppression before menses make us use larger dose of gonadotropin because there is no endogenous gonadotropin present. So we have obliged to use large dose, which may increase the cost of the cycle. The another problem, I cannot use gene-rich agonist in trigger of ovulation here. And we should use HCG, only HCG, so increase rate of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. The idea is the agonist first act as a stimulator, then occupy receptor after few days, so work as antagonist when we begin gonadotropin. Short agonist protocol. Why to begin agonist before menses? I can begin agonist just in first or second day with the induction. The idea, I benefit from the early flare up or agonistic effect of gonadotropin, which induce ovulation. So I decrease number of gonadotropin, give better result, give more follicle and more ova. So it's ideal for poor responder. The problem, I cannot control well, because here in the long agonist protocol, I begin in a very hypoestrogenic state, induction or a basal line. Here I begin the second day and with induction. So less synchronization occur, and the result of this protocol generally is not good. Only we use it in old age or poor responder. Antagonist protocol. The idea begin induction with gonadotropin. There is no down regulation before, so dose of the gonadotropin should be less, so the cost may be less than agonist protocol. But the problem is the antagonist itself is price is very high regarding as when compared to agonist. Example for this sitrotide, 0.25 milligram daily. And when begin either fixed in a 6 day of induction protocol, from 6 to 8 days, you can usually begin in a 6 day, or flexible when the leading follicle reach 14 millimeter, begin antagonist protocol after gonadotropin. Suitable high responder, because here as a trigger, I can use GnRH agonist, because the receptor is not occupied by agonist, and agonist will be effective, unlike long agonist protocol, which agonist may be ineffective because I use it for long time, so downregulation occur. Here, I can use agonist as a trigger, and this is the benefit of this protocol to decrease ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. Also, on poor responder, I can use it to increase the yield of ovum or oocyte. Another idea to use what's called agonist-antagonist convergent protocol. Agonist-antagonist convergent protocol, I begin in 21 day by agonist, and then induction by gonadotropin, and change agonist to antagonist to make a benefit. I can give agonist as a trigger here, and also I make more synchronization than only antagonist protocol. Last one, use of progesterone. As like long agonist protocol, instead of GnRH agonist, I use progesterone. Benefit when there is no available GnRH agonist or antagonist, or unavailable some situation, I can use progesterone instead. Disadvantage, you must freeze all embryo, and no fresh embryo transfer, and should we use frozen cycle, freeze all. Thank you. Hello everybody, today we speak about second lecture of ICSI and assisted reproduction about gonadotropin. What's type? Either human menopausal gonadotropin or highly purified human menopausal gonadotropin, or urinary FSH, or highly purified FSH, or recently recombinant FSH, or recombinant LH using recombinant technology. There is another recent product, long-acting recombinant FSH, which not widely used in our country. Regimen: either begin with fixed dose and continue with the same dose, and this is the preferred regimen in most of cycles, assist the reduction cycle, or either begin with large dose or big dose and gradually decrease the dose, which known as step down protocol, or either begin with small dose and if needed increase the dose. For myself, I prefer fixed dose, which product will produce more quality over and better success rate. A step down may be used if I fear of hyperstimulation syndrome, but the problem in this a lot of follicle may be arthritic. Step up if I during induction protocol I find the response suboptimal, I have to choose either to cancel the cycle or to increase the dose. The problem of increasing dose is that the effect is delayed, because melatonin to produce increase in the dose to produce effect, it needs to 3 to 7 days. So I saw cancellation of cycle better than increasing dose. Also, there is a risk of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. The important question, and most of the people working in ICSI or acetyl reduction, what is the beginning dose? أبدأ بجرعة قد إيه؟ What is the beginning dose with the patient? دي أهم نقطة ونقطة محورية في success rate بتاعنا في حالات الإكسي والأسيستر برودكشن، لأن الاختياري ده هيتوقف عليه حاجات كتيرة، وإحنا زي ما عرفنا قبل كده إن التشينج والفلكسبيليتي قليلة خالص، إن أنا أزود الجرعة أو الجرعة بيؤدي إلى ديكريز أو نقص في نسبة النجاح. طب إيه العوامل اللي تخليني أختار الجرعة بتاعتي؟ In general, the beginning dose usually 22.5، يعني 225 دي دايما الجرعة اللي بنبدأ بيها في الاندكشن بتاعنا في حالات الاكس، وبنبدأ في السكند داي اوف سايكل او بعد ما بننجح في الداون ريجوليشن والسيرم استراديول بيقل اقل من 40 او 30 بيكوغرام بالمليلتر. دي الجرعة النورمال بتاعنا، لكن في عوامل كتيرة بتحدد ان نزود او نقص، منهم البودي ويت. الأوبيز دايما أميل إن أنا أزود الجرعة، منهم الـ AMH ده مهم جدا حسب الليفل بتاع الـ AMH. لو الـ AMH ده فيري لو، متوقع إن العينة دي هتبقى بور ريسبوندر، فبالتالي هبدأ بجرعة أعلى. لو هو وزن نورمال يبقى أمشي الستاندرد دوز، لو هو هاي AMH وحالات الـ BCO أميل إن أنا أنقص الجرعة 75 مثلا أو أكتر. من ضمن العوامل التانية اللي هتفرق معايا الـ age، العمر العياني دي كام؟ الـ old age برضه نفس الكلام، أميل إن أنا أزود الجرعة بتاعتي. الـ previous response بتاعي، لو كان في هي قبل كده معاها history إن هي كان في poor responder قبل كده وحصل cancellation للسايكل due to poor response أو failure للسايكل نتيجة إن number of oocytes كان أقل من 3 مثلا مرة أو مرتين، يبقى أميل إن أنا increase the dose. الماكسيموم بتاعي يعني في اختلاف، في ناس بتقول 300، في ناس بتقول مثلا 375 او 450، لكن في الناس البول ريسبونس اميل ان انا to increase the dose. الناس اللي عندهم previous ovarian surgery اميل ان انا to increase dose. الناس اللي عندهم polycystic ovarian syndrome اميل ان الدوز بتاعتي تكون قليله to decrease the risk بتاع ovarian hyperstimulation والmultiple pregnancy. من ضمن العوامل التانية اللي تفرق معايا، احنا قلنا البودي ويت، لو هي سن برضه اميل ان انا اقلل الجرعة، لو هي اوبيز اميل ان انا ازود الجرعة بتاعتي. برضه من ضمن الحياة، احنا لو لقينا البيزا دي في السيتش بتاعنا اكتر من 10 اميل ان انا ازود الجرعة بتاعتي. ايه التايب اوف جوناتروفين؟ طبعا في a lot of preparation موجودة في الكونفنشن وفي الريسنت، في اللي هو تشيب وفي اكسبنسيف. هل لما نيجي نقارن بالهيومن مونوبوزال جونادوتروفين ولا الهاي بروفايد هيومن مونوبوزال جونادوتروفين، الليتريتشر والريسيرش بتقول معظمهم ما فيش اختلاف كتير، لكن على واقع التجربه انا شايف ان الهاي بروفايد اتش ام جي، النتائج بتاعته احسن من اتش ام جي الاورديناري، مشكلته ان هو مور اكسبنسيف عن الاورديناري اتش ام جي. لما نيجي نقارن الريكومبرانت فيرسس يورينري اف اس اتش، يعني برضو الريتريتشر برضو معظمها بتقول ان هما نيرلي ذا سيم ايكوال. اي نعم في الجور سموندر الريكومبرانت بتبقى افضل شويه، لكن جنرال برضو الريكومبرانت ليه بعض المزايا. How to trigger ovulation in a case of IVF and ICSI. What's meant maturation of the follicle. First, by using human chorionic gonadotropin HCG. It is like LH, but have long duration of action, half life about 7 days. Ordinary HCG, we use urinary HCG or more pure recombinant HCG. The results are comparable, but recombinant are preferred, but it's more expensive. Urinary, like Coriomone, 5,000 unit, or Ebifasi, 5,000 unit. We can use 10,000 unit to ampoule intramuscular, or use recombinant HCG in market known as Ovitril, 250 unit, used subcutaneous, and we can use two ampoule to induce trigger ovulation. The ovum pickup or oocyte retrieval should be done about 36 hours after injection. Another way of using trigger ovulation, GnRH agonist. Like decarbectin, we can use 4 ampoule subcutaneous, and oocyte retrieval should be 40 hours after injection، يعني حوالي 40 ساعة، يعني 4 ساعات متأخر عن ال HCG. عيوب ال HCG كلنا عارفينها، إن هو risk of ovarian hyperstimulation but benefit a lot because maturation of the follicle better with HCG. But the NRH agonist carry benefit of decreased risk of ovarian hyperstimulation syndrome. To use the NRH agonist, we should not use agonist in down regulation. So it's suitable only for antagonist protocol or when using progesterone. It's not suitable for long acting agonist protocol. Another way to trigger what's called dual trigger, we can use both HCG or GnRH agonist in trigger ovulation. At the same time, we carry benefit of the GnRH agonist decrease ovarian hyperstimulation. And we carry a benefit of CG to adrenal for support and more effective. Another way, double trigger. We can use first GnRH agonist, and after 4 hours, we use HCG. Then oocyte retrieval 36 hours after HCG or 40 hours after GnRH agonist. Oocyte retrieval or ovum pickup. What is the technique of this procedure? First, timing, when to do this. Ideally, about 36 hours after trigger by HCG. First, it was done through the laparoscopy in transabdominal, recently done under vaginal ultrasonographic guidance. Sure, under general anesthesia or light anesthesia, and the patient in lithotomy position, and the probe is prepared transvaginal probe with the needle inside the guidance through the probe. And the vagina should be cleaned with normal saline. Betadine is not used since it may be toxic to the egg. This is a suction device used to do oocyte retrieval or ovum pickup. And this is the collecting tube which transferred to embryologist for examination. This is the shape of the needle, about 17 needle group, and this sharp needle. And this is the shape, imagine the shape in the needle inside the follicle and aspirate fluid and aspirate ova and cumulus ova around the ova. We need 17 group needle. All follicle within both ovary are aspirated, then by examined by embryologist. The technique is simply like this, transvaginal, and the needle appeared in the scan. We begin by nearest follicles in the middle in the far follicle and should be in order and try to not enter and re-enter the follicle. The follicle which be aspirated should be in the middle of the screen. This is a picture of the iliac vein which should be avoided during aspiration because it may lead to severe hemorrhage or massive hemorrhage. Thanks a lot. They were speaking about very important subject, luteal phase support in IVF ICSI. What's the etiology of this condition? In each cycle of ICSI or RT, there is luteal phase defects caused by either large quantity of granulosa cells removal during oocyte retrieval or due to HCG administration, which suppresses luteinizing hormone. And lastly, due to continued downregulation by gonadotropin releasing hormone agonist. Does the protocol affect both agonist and antagonist protocol require retal phase defect and both require support? What is the option? There is a lot of option, either progesterone or HCG or estradiol or gonadotropin releasing hormone and lastly co-treatment. The classic support was progesterone. First is oral ingestion or oral route. Oral progesterone is extensively metabolized by the liver, so there is reduced bioavailability, except dihydrogesterone. However, the effect of oral is less effective than vaginal or intramuscular. In a study, there is dihydrogesterone versus progesterone for luteal support. Dihydrogesterone seems to be as effective as vaginal progesterone for luteal phase support in RT cycle. Intramuscular injection is preferred route for administration, rapidly absorbed, peak level, and most reliable route to achieve desired concentration of progesterone in serum, especially in the serum and effect in the immune system. A dose between 50 to 100 milligram. Vaginal progesterone to reach high level of uterine concentration and despite low serum concentration. Another advantage, it does not cause drowsiness or sleepiness, but there is a problem of vaginal discharge. This picture shows that the intramuscular progesterone, there is high serum level, but low intravaginal level, but with vaginal progesterone, endometrial level is high, but lower in intramuscular route. Gel foam may be referred to the over suppository. There is no need to lie flat after insertion. Dose is 90 milligram daily. In comparison with uterogestin, there is a slight increase on rate of pregnancy rate with crinone no vaginal gel. Erectel is not widely accepted when there is no clinical trial about it. Timing of retail support, when to begin, not later than 3 days after oocyte retrieval. HCG may cover about maximum 8 days, so you should prefer to begin 3 days after oocyte retrieval. Not delay it. If you appointment about 1 day after oocyte retrieval, another appointment 2 days after oocyte retrieval. When to stop, minimum 2 weeks after day of embryo transfer or 18 days after following oocyte retrieval. But most of opinion prefer to continue progesterone till 7 weeks. Another option is human chorionic gonadotropin. It's an indirect form to stimulate corpus luteum to produce progesterone. الدوز 1052 to 2000 and in comparison with progesterone there is no apparent difference. Disadvantage increased rate of ovarian hyperstress syndrome may intervene with pregnancy test to know if the patient is pregnant or not. So CZE is not preferred if E2 level more than 2,500 on the day of HCG administration before OSAT retrieval, or the number of follicles more than 10. The third one is estradiol very late. This idea mostly we give only progesterone, but estradiol is low also in the luteal phase, which natural cycle be high level of estrogen or steady level of estrogen in luteal phase. This is the idea to give estrogen in combination with progesterone. The rule is not clear. The studies show that the difference in pregnancy rate between the two regimen of progesterone only or combined with estrogen is very small. Another one, the gonadotropin releasing hormone. This is support corpuscularity by stimulating secretion of LH by the pituitary, acting بدل مادة ال HCG ممكن أدي DNA analog و ال pituitary بتطلع ال transcription hormone. برضه ليه effect تاني إنه ممكن acting in endometrium by locally expressed GnRH receptor, also direct effect in embryos. Single dose given 5 days after ICSI. Results of Cochrane database systemic review. Oral route is associated with reduction of pregnancy rate, so it's not preferred. There is evidence of benefit of intramuscular over vaginal route in terms of outcome, ongoing pregnancy rate and life birth rate. Because the effect in serum is high and immunomodulation is more prominent than vaginal root. There is no significant difference in pregnancy between vaginal gel and other type of preparation. There is no significant difference between progesterone or HCG or between progesterone and progesterone plus HCG or estrogen. Co-treatment, last option. Co-treatment, most of them, there is no solid evidence to use it as ascorbic acid. Steroid, no proven efficacy. Aspirin, controversial because it increases blood flow. Sildenafil, also controversial. Low molecular weight heparin, anticoagulant effect, modulated blood cyst apposition, adherence, and division may benefit, but avoid routine use until further research. Granulocyte colon stimulating factor, promising role. Intravenous immunoglobulin reduced natural killer cell activity, lack of evidence. Atosiban may reduce uterine contractility, further study required. And lastly, neuromuscular electrical stimulation. Thank you very much.